Honors. May it please the Court, my name is Julian Swanson. I represent Mr. Stephen Turner in this case. And this is an appeal of the Social Security Disability Benefits Denial. With regard to both Social Security Disability Insurance and Supplemental Security Income, there are five overarching issues that we have presented. The first is with regard to the residual functional capacity finding by the AL judge in this case. The problem with this is that the ALJ himself found moderate limitations in all three areas of functioning, including concentration, persistence, and pace, and then proceeded to find that Mr. Turner was capable of performing simple repetitive tasks with occasional public contact and at all exertional levels. The problem here is that RFC, as a matter of law, fails to reflect the moderate limitations in concentration, persistence, and pace. Now, why this becomes a problem and why this is different than the cases that the commissioner relies on is the ALJ doesn't explain.
Limitations in concentration, persistence, or pace, or concentration, persistence, and pace?
It's or.
Okay.
I think I misspoke. The difference with this case and what lines this case up with the Ninth Circuit's decision in Brink in 2015 and in 2009 is that the ALJ doesn't explain why he's not reflecting that moderate limitation. The commissioner relies on Stubbs Danielson, as do a lot of the cases that are dealing with this issue.
Brink is an unpublished opinion.
I'm sorry?
The Brink cases were unpublished.
Correct.
Why should we care about that?
We should care about them because, first of all, they're directly on point.
Yes, but we don't care about them, so I wouldn't rely on them.
Well, then let me talk about Stubbs Danielson. And then I would like to come back to that because district courts...
District courts do, but we always tell them not to, and they do.
Fair enough. So in Stubbs Danielson, which is published in out of this court, it distinguished itself from a Seventh Circuit case from 2003 named Casarsi versus Barnhart. And Stubbs Danielson explains that the reason that what the judge did there, where there was a finding of moderate limitations in concentration, persistence, and pace, but also an RFC of simple repetitive tasks. The court distinguished from Casarsi because in Casarsi, the court there omitted any reasoning for dropping the explanation as to why a simple repetitive task, RFC, didn't reflect the moderate limitations in concentration, persistence, and pace. So in essence, Casarsi is saying the same thing as Brink. And Stubbs Danielson distinguishes itself from that on the very same basis.
And if we find there was no error in the residual functional capacity assessment and any of the first four steps, is there still any error that you can allege in step five, or do all of the alleged step five errors relate back to the earlier errors?
It's an interesting question, because in step five, there is a problem with what the vocational expert testified to insofar as he testified that Mr. Turner could perform level two reasoning. All three jobs that the vocational expert testified he could perform involved level two reasoning, which is defined by the Dictionary of Occupational Titles. Level 2 reasoning requires some attention to detailed instructions and tasks. And the Ninth Circuit has never come out and said that in itself is in conflict with simple repetitive tasks. However, and granted this is another unpublished case, but Lupin, out of this district, has said that one...
We really don't rely on unpublished opinions. We really don't. We can't.
So,
if we did, we would completely upset our whole system for deciding cases.
So, it, at step five, what the vocational expert does is provide level two reasoning, which by definition requires dealing with detailed tasks in response to an RFC that's restricted to simple and repetitive tasks alone. And the RFC, which, you know, the ALJ doesn't give us a lot to follow as far as his reasoning is concerned, but what is in the record is from a Dr. Behrens, is the state agency psychologist, who specifically said that he could not, or he would be moderately limited with regard to with detail-oriented tasks or instructions. So I do think that there's a problem with the vocational expert placing him in a workplace that requires level two reasoning.
What, in your view, is the relevant medical evidence in the record? Is it just the report of Dr. Behrens?
Your Honor, that's a very hard question. This is a huge record. And the basis of the disability makes this extra difficult to follow. It's a personality disorder. We've got a claimant who is, you know, not only traveling in and out of different jurisdictions, but he's in prison. He's in psychiatric institutions. So we've got treatment teams following him throughout the years. We've got evidence of his dysfunction throughout the years.
Just answer my question, then. What is the relevant medical evidence?
I would say the prison treatment teams following him. In early 2010, Dr. Gluck gives him a gaffe of, I believe it was 35. This is right around the date he was last insured for disability benefits. A gaffe of 5 is an extremely dysfunctional gaffe that would make it almost impossible for him to function outside of an institution. So, like I said, it's a difficult question to answer because, and as I laid out in my brief, we've got treatment evidence, you know, spanning from his
80s. From the time frame, what time frames we're talking about, and whether he's taking his medication or not at the various times.
Well, the initial psychological and psychiatric testing, which was done when he lost his medical license, which I believe was in the 90s, maybe the late 80s, gives him a prognosis of, a poor prognosis of ever succeeding. You know, whether or not medication is treating depression.
That's not really what we're talking about here.
I'm sorry, Your Honor.
Of ever succeeding as a doctor, which is not really what we're talking about here.
I would say it was ever succeeding in life. I mean, he was committing crimes at that point, which is why he ended up losing his medical license.
That was in 1998, right?
Thank you very much.
Sure.
And if I may step back into the steps 2 and 3 of the ALJ's decision and the determination process. Again, there's a problem here because the ALJ is giving us only boilerplate language, saying things like, based on the evidence of record, you know, X, and having the conclusion follow that, gives us no way to have a meaningful conversation over what the ALJ felt was important, what the ALJ felt was that he could disregard, and that leaves us in a situation where it's very difficult to even have this discussion.
But you're not contesting, for example, the ALJ's finding as to what the severe impairments were, which were narcissistic personality disorder and antisocial personality disorder. So, for example, although there is material running across some of the medical reports about depression and anxiety and bipolar disorder, the ALJ didn't find any of that. You're not contesting it.
That's not true. We are contesting it. We're saying that he doesn't mention, that's not true. He does mention medical records with different diagnoses, but when he decides there's only 2 severe impairments, there's no analysis as to why he disregards the physical impairments. There's multiple psychiatric diagnoses that maybe could have or should have been involved in whether or not Mr. Turner met or equaled a listing. We've got 12.4.
Yes, go ahead. But I didn't understand you to be contesting that conclusion as such.
We contest all of his findings insofar as his analysis is absent from the record. The way that he comes up with only 2 I don't contest that those are severe, but I do contest the fact that he is ignoring a vast part of the record.
Go ahead. I have time, so why don't we just have you come back with me. I'll give you 2 minutes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Turning first to Appellant's arguments regarding ALJ's step two and step three findings. And this is a theme I think throughout that we outlined in our answering brief, that Appellant relies heavily on arguments presented initially at the appellate level, arguments that were not raised before the ALJ as required in this court's ruling in Meadow, and did not raise arguments regarding, for example, a step two finding, arguments about whether the claimant equals a listing, arguments about the VE testimony. These arguments were not raised at the district court level either. And so under this court's precedent in Gregor, in Meadow, Edlund, these cases all apply the waiver rule in Social Security cases, and especially in cases such as this where the claimant was represented at all levels, and the court should do so here.
The ALJ opinion is pretty bare bones, isn't it? On several issues, like the credibility question and why he concluded that there were just these two severe decisions, even though there were findings about bipolar disorder and depression and anxiety and so on. So he really doesn't explain himself very well.
The ALJ's decision, it's a voluminous record, and I think we could agree that the ALJ could probably discuss more of the evidence, but I think the evidence that the ALJ did discuss in the decision provides sufficient foundation for his findings at step two and step three. Turning first to the step two argument, without waiving the waiver argument that I just mentioned, I think it's important to realize that under this court's precedent, especially in Sample and I think in subsequent cases, the record may contain numerous diagnoses of impairments, but in themselves, they're not sufficient to establish the existence of limitations. And so while you might find citations to...
Well, somebody really had bipolar disorder, and there was a lot of discussion about grandiosity and so on. Don't you think some reason to discount that?
Well, I think in this case, I think the ALJ looked at the totality records, saw his treatment, and determined that narcissistic personality disorder and antisocial personality disorder were the two impairments that I think best captured, I guess, the claimants.
Those are both sort of slightly pejorative, aren't they? I mean, they're kind of, you're a bad guy. Whereas bipolar disorder at this point is actually taken seriously as a psychiatric illness. And it's never accounted for.
Well, I don't think the ALJ viewed this claimant in a pejorative manner, Your Honor, because the ALJ acknowledges in the decision that the claimant had severe psychiatric disturbance. And I think the ALJ acknowledged it, took it seriously, and did not minimize that the claimant had severe impairments that significantly limited his ability to work. I think the question was whether the claimant's impairments satisfied the definition of disability as set forth under the Social Security Act. And I think the ALJ looked at the record and then looked at the amount of benign mental status examinations, the claimant's documented improvement with treatment, and the claimant's, in the statements from his therapist, and who said that he was at low risk of recidivism, that his condition was, I think, at one point 99.9% under control. And I think the ALJ acknowledges that, yes, the claimant, has these impairments and throughout the relevant period had significant mental impairments, but
still determined that they did not rise to a level that might be
provoking. One of the things he says was that the claimant says he's writing a book, so that proves that he really isn't as bad as he thinks he is. But if he has bipolar disorder, he could easily think he's writing a book and not be writing a book, or not be capable of writing a book.
Well, Your Honor, I think that's... That is one interpretation of what he could be doing, but I think
but it's never dealt with. That's what bothers me. It's just never mentioned.
Well, I think the ALJ does not, you know, in the decision, contemplate alternative interpretation of what the claimant situation. The ALJ simply sort of elected and explained his own interpretation, which was that the claimant's ability to research and be involved in his ongoing experiences in the criminal justice system and take an active role in that.
And he might, but we see an awful lot of pretty crazy filings here by people who I would think, just by looking at them, I don't see the filings. I mean, they could have been, of the manic kind we often get. I don't know. Well, nor did he, apparently.
It could be, but there's no evidence, actually, that indicates that it was, and I think it's also...
Well, he's suing his parole board, he's suing his therapist. I mean, it's all a little nutty, I'd say.
I think an assumption based on his impairments that the record doesn't support, Your Honor, in all honesty, because I think we've got his therapist who note his normal mental status findings when it comes to his fund of information, his attention, his concentration, his memory, his organized cognition is clear, his cooperative attitude, his calm demeanor. I think the records illustrate that these are findings that his treatment providers made.
If we find that ALJ erred in failing to justify the credibility finding, is that grounds for reversal?
It isn't in this case, Your Honor, because I think this is an atypical credibility finding in this case, because I think this is an atypical circumstance.
I'm sorry, did you hear that? I didn't hear what you said.
Oh, yeah, Your Honor, I'm sorry. I think I was getting the
question. Atypical
circumstance. Atypical credibility finding, because in most, in a typical Social Security case, I realize I'm speaking in a microphone now, in a typical Social Security case, you'll have a claimant who will outline specific symptoms and how they affect their ability to perform specific work activities. Like, it's typical to see somebody say, like, I can only walk 10 minutes in a day, I spend most of the day lying down, I'm incapable of reading, I'm incapable of doing X, Y, and Z. In this circumstance, whenever claimant, at the hearing, when the claimant was asked, why can't you work? The claimant didn't make any of these kind of allegations. The claimant instead said that he said that his behavior throughout his sort of period of incarceration and subsequent was exemplary. He testified to that at the hearing, and he instead attributed his difficulties not to his mental impairments, but to his involvement in the criminal justice system, to the restrictions on his that in place on him while he was on parole. He didn't link it to his mental impairments. So as a result, that's why the ALJ noted that even if you credit the claimant's statements as true in this circumstance, that they still don't. Even accepting them, it still means that he can still work.
What significance, I guess, do you, or should it have, or do you think it should have, that Mr. Turner spent so much time in and out of prison in recent years? Is there?
I don't know what significance I can make from. I think what the ALJ made from that was that we have a circumstance, and I think the ALJ notes that in the case that the claimant had periods where he went back to prison and had made sort of threats that he might engage in self-harm if he went back to prison. And it was noted in the decision that at no point was this attributed to sort of an acute psychiatric emergency or that he met the criteria for acute psychiatric care. Instead, he sort of was trying to avoid incarceration. And so I think there are a couple things going on here. I think we have a situation where we have a claimant who does have severe mental impairments. The ALJ acknowledges it and limits the claimant to simple repetitive work with limited public contact. And the ALJ determined, based on the normal findings, Dr. Barron's opinion, which also endorses this particular RFC finding.
Is Dr. Barron's the only medical relevant?
It is, Your Honor.
Not the doctors or the people at the institution.
It's noteworthy that none of them precluded him from working. And at one point, one of his treatment providers.
There's a funny business that goes on in these cases where when the doctors I mean, why isn't just their diagnoses relevant? And their observations. Why do they have to be people who actually opine directly on whether he could work or not?
Well, we do have their observations, and their observations, the ALJ and his report, were actually consistent with the ability to work. I think the ALJ notes these observations to include the claimant's improvement with treatment, the claimant's normal mental status findings. Those are observations they made that the ALJ determined support the non-disability finding. And so it's not that the ALJ disregarded those findings. The ALJ actually determined that they actually endorsed the non-disability finding along with Dr. Barron's opinion. So that's the evidence that overall, I mean, regardless of, the claimant's sort of involvement in the criminal justice system.
Yes, Your Honor. The ALJ's failure to adequately discuss Dr. Barron's opinion in the decision could be a fatal error. Looking at Marsh, et cetera.
Well, Your Honor, we don't believe that it would be a basis for error in this case because Dr. Barron's opinion is entirely consistent with the RFC. That the ALJ found. The ALJ didn't explicitly discuss Dr. Barron's opinion in the decision, that is correct, but Dr. Barron's in October 2011 reviewed the record and determined that the claimant could perform simple repetitive tasks, limited public contact, which is essentially equivalent to the ALJ's RFC finding.
In fact, it should have discussed Dr. Barron's opinion.
Dr. Barron's opinion would have, an explicit discussion of Dr. Barron's opinion at length would have, we agree, strengthen the ALJ's decision, but given that Dr. Barron's opinion is entirely consistent with the RFC finding, that there's no basis for remand based on the ALJ's non-discussion of Dr. Barron's opinion, given that they're entirely consistent with one another.
But the only medical relevant, or the only medical evidence you say was Dr. Barron's, and here the ALJ didn't discuss the medical evidence.
Well,
they didn't discuss Dr. Barron's report or analysis. What's the authority that that's okay?
Well, we believe that that would fall under this court's harmless error precedent, where the ALJ's non-discussion of an opinion that in no way undermines the ALJ's RFC finding would be the inconsequential to the ultimate disability determination, which is consistent with the harmless error precedent.
What is the relevant time period here?
The relevant time period in this case, Your Honor, stems from this claimant's alleged onset date of disability, which I believe is February 1st, 2006, and it runs into.
So, for example, we have a medical a doctor's opinion in March 2010 that he had a GAF of 38. Isn't that a pretty good indication that he can't work?
Well, the agency doesn't recognize GAF scores as equaling, as being equivalent to the agency's severity rules.
Well, I know, but there's no discussion of any of this. I mean, the opinion has nothing in there about at least a fair number of fairly extreme conclusions by various doctors over a long period of time. And in particular, I don't think they mentioned the word bipolar disorder, even though it appears in the record 3 or 4 different times. And it's not, I mean, it seems like there's something selective about what the IJ is putting in here because it doesn't even mention that.
Well, I think the ALJ does reference some of the claimant's low GAF scores, but it's also noteworthy that the ALJ notes that there were repeated instances where the claimant received GAF scores of 60 or above, which.
Right, okay, but he doesn't discuss any of that.
Well, I think when it comes to determining whether the importance of that, I think it's worth stepping back that the claimant still bears the burden of establishing that his impairments impose limitations beyond, to establish reversible error, that his impairments established greater limitations than set forth in the RFC. So we can look at these diagnoses, but at the end of the day, we have a mountain of evidence that shows that the claimant repeatedly had normal mental status findings, especially when it came to his attention, concentration, fund of information, his attitude, behavior, and couple that with his documented improvement with treatment, which is, and in particular, he mentions that Depakote effects were very effective in managing his mood and anxiety symptoms, anger, any other psychiatric symptoms that's found throughout the record. The totality of that evidence establishes that regardless of, whether it's 2 psychiatric diagnoses or 3 or whatever, that the RFC was appropriate in this instance and that there was substantial evidence to support that particular finding.
Okay.
no further questions, Your Honor.
Okay, thank you very much, Your Honor.
Okay, then we will request that the court affirm the district court's order. Thank you.
Yes, sir, I'll give you 2 minutes for rebuttal.
Listening to the commissioner argue about the ALJ's analysis goes to the heart of the problem here, and I think Your Honor's were pointing that out very well. While he may make convincing arguments, the district court may have made convincing arguments that we can't replace our judgment after the fact for the ALJ's, and the ALJ's rationale is missing. I also want to comment that when we're talking about treatment teams in prisons and mental institutions, these treatment teams are not going to be discussing somebody's ability to work. Their focus is somebody's ability to be safe right now and or, you know, it's a very different context. This isn't a clinical evaluation. This is not a...
You'd think a discussion about parole would include that.
I'm sorry?
You'd think an evaluation for parole purposes would include ability to work.
Yes, but I also think there's sort of a baseline functioning. So, you know, in a context of somebody being released under parole, to say, you know, he's able to function from that point of view, that is not the same as being able to work. That is, he's going to be safe to be released into the public so long as, you know, and for Mr. Turner, so long as he doesn't go around schools, so long as he's not around children. I mean, he had all of these other conditions.
What is the relevance of that? I mean, he can't be around children, he can't be around school. That's going to be awful limiting in terms of what jobs he can do. I gather that this analysis just apples to oranges, or just have nothing to do with each other.
Yeah,
and there's a question of what jobs you can do, so that doesn't take into account those other limitations.
It's exactly right. I mean, we're talking about him being a janitor, or I should say the vocational expert was talking about putting him to work as a janitor, when in reality, he can't be around the public. So even though there was an RFC limiting his interaction...
Right, I mean, that's just the way the system works, or whatever.
Yeah, fair enough.
Okay.
And the only other thing I wanted to... You know, I know Your Honors have the record before you, but the idea that taking away Mr. Turner's credibility, the credibility determination is not harmful here, is misleading. If you read his testimony, what he says is that he has had problems in every job he's tried. This is a man who has tried
to... But didn't the ALJ go right on to say, besides just mattering for pay?
But he doesn't explain how that's true. He doesn't explain any part of it. He discredits him, and then he says, well, you know, regardless, if I credit him, I get to the same conclusion. And so, again, you know, we're left wondering how in the world he gets there. And, you know, he doesn't take into consideration what Mr. Turner actually testified to, which was that he has been unable to work for decades based on his problems getting along with people, which is how he describes it. But Your Honor's right, when you start getting into these different mental impairments, it's difficult to rely on a claimant's ability to diagnose themselves, especially when they're going in and out of all of these institutions and they have all of these different diagnoses.
Okay, your time is up. Thank both of you for your argument. The case of Turner versus Berryhill is submitted.